We keep stuff.
Yeah.
How's it going, everybody?
Just think that I'm going down.
We send the person to the public issue to a state hospital to take a facility diagnosis and treatment. What do we do with the person in particular?
Well, in my experience, the addicted parent has the ability to go to the substance treatment program. There's the heart house. There's an issue with health recovery, which is a referral program in which you can go and present there. 3 days of designing there, your child is unified. You must be being in the program for 6 to 12 months. You have to comply with the program's treatment.
Okay, so, example, I'm going to give you, you're on the bench.
In that instance, no. I would hope that I would want services in place to be able to.
Why wouldn't you commit?
Because I think that it's heroin, he's an addict, he needs treatment. I don't think that he needs to be committed to DYS. He needs to be these services that could be available.
So, you send him on his way with the suggestion in front of him. And he's back before you go a month later.
Analysis.
simply failed the urine test. The second time, the probation officer says, judge, a month ago with him, I asked you to come in, and he didn't. His urine has turned up dirty again for the second time. I asked you to come in this time. You say you don't think you would commit it? Does that mean you might?
No, I would not commit it. I would want to have services.
So then a month later, he's back for the third time. Want another urine test? Probably not. Again, the probation officer says, first time I was here, I asked you. Second time I was here, this is the third time I'm asking you.
I just want him to see.
No, no, not, we're talking about what you want him to do. I'm asking you to rule on the probation officer's request. Do you commit him or not commit him?
I think I might commit him. So that he might ask to get the services and treatment that he needs. I don't believe that he would be in a lot
okay,
of facilities for those situations.
Well, if you're committed, you're going to be in a lot of facility, right? When you get committed and you're not in the box.
At GYMs, they have foster homes. They have unlocked facilities where there's a residential placement for juveniles to go to and have treatment at the residential. There's a classification. So in order to be locked in, a juvenile locked in a locked facility, it has to be egregious crimes that this juvenile has been
determined. How do you know where he's going to get committed? When you say, fine, I'm going to commit you again, you know. 60 days in the youth detention facility service, and you send them off in handcuffs. How do you know where they're going?
Once he's committed, he's committed to the Department of Youth Services
right.
Until he turns 18.
And that's their position to decide where he goes,
right.
Not yours.
It is
right?
Not.
So you don't know whether he's going to a foster home or whether he's going to a locked facility over in Roswell.
I would not, because it would not be my control as to how the classes.
So, you told me you wouldn't commit him the first time because he wouldn't get any benefit from that commitment, right?
Correct.
And you want him to be in a non-locked facility, so when you commit him, you have no authority to tell DYS what to do with him. They take him. They put them in a life facility. Why would you change your opinion about commitments the first to the third time?
Because the goal of the court is to rehabilitate the juvenile.
No, you told me that putting them in a life facility, committing them, would not be in his best interest as a criminal
at the onset.
Right. So, why would it be in his benefit? Third time you fail the test.
Because he might be able to see, be able to be forced to have the treatment that is necessary.
Or what if he says, no, I don't want the treatment? What if you say to him, this is your third time, I'm going to either send you to treatment, would you go to treatment? And he says, no, I don't want treatment. I'm going to fail again.
My goal would be to.
I don't want to know your goal. We all have goals for the best. We all have those goals. I assume that in every day. But I don't see it on the bench all the time. I see judge committing people because they beat it to a cop. Came out and put it in a box of service. And I don't understand that. So what it convinced me I should understand.
I think the DYS services is very, very different than the correctional services for adults.
Well, let me just stop here. I know there's a difference. But when I go to the House of Correction in Devon, and I go to the Black Facility in Roswell, I don't notice a big difference in the facility. They both got iron doors, both got keys to move around, guards,
strong possibility that he will.
If the fact that heroin addicts, there's a strong possibility that heroin addicts will overdose, shouldn't we allow them all out so they don't die? Can that be the answer?
No, it's a disease that doesn't need to be treated.
But you're going to put it in because you're going to relapse.
I think the instance you're giving me is a very simple case.
It's just very simple.
Correct.
No new charges on the youngster. Parents say he hasn't done anything at home. Bad. Just use it. Violated your probation order.
For the third time. And it might be best that he seek treatment in DYS.
It might not either, right? You might go to a lot of DYS facility and get it right. Right? You know that sometimes that happens.
Yeah, I do.
And abuse sexually. Right?
And
so why would you take the chance that you're sitting there and something happens? As opposed to leaving him in his house. Who did he hurt by relapsing?
In a scenario, I don't think that it wasn't.
He hurt himself anyway, right? He didn't die. He still would say he died. You're going to take him out of that home and put him in a facility that is a violent facility. What's he got on that? See, my view is that that's why the court system should be handling the issues. It's designed to punish. I mean, if you go to the claims to treatment for some alcohol or drug rehab, they don't usually throw you out when you relapse. They don't usually punish you.
Oh, yeah.
They don't throw you into the jail system. They treat you because they recognize and understand the disease. I don't think a lot of people in the court system do what they want to judge. I don't know whether you do. Do you?
I believe I do.
Again, so my position on your experience on the criminal side is I view the job as not only powerful positions in state government. We are going to give you the right to be hired. You're going to make $160,000 a year in medical benefits, vacation, nice pension at the end of it. And you go through a JNC, and you come here. My view is when you sit in that chair, there shouldn't be any, I'm going to learn it later on after I get out. Because when you're learning things you don't know about, you can hurt them. And those people you will hurt are citizens of the Commonwealth that have sent us here to protect them. So, I guess I don't want to talk anything about that. Help me out. Side of that for me is at least some of our So. How much do you wait to get to be a judge? How much do you think trial experience? Now, you have these CNP trials that you have mentioned here. That's not with your.
No, it's essential.
And a lot of cases, when's the last one you've done?
Full determination part races June this year. I had five files here on barracks in September. Temporary custody hearings.
How do you think of minimum mandatory sentences? Okay, well, there is. What do you think about the person who is a lawyer? No opinion? Mandatory sentences? You hear somebody gets 20-year mandatory sentence in a court. You don't think about that? Fine.
Well, I think that the legislature has set the laws that my job is to be effective.
Okay. So if you're sitting on a court and somebody's before you that you are sentenced, and according to the law, you have to give a sentence. You personally believe is unfair. What are you going to do? Give the unfair sentence? Because the legislature said it?
I would have to. I would only need to work over the law.
What happens if you don't have to vote?
If I don't have to vote for the law?
What if somebody says this is what the legislature said you've got to do, and you say, you know, I know they did, but that's not. What do you think will happen?
I don't know, but I don't believe that I would deviate from the mandatory sentence by going into the whole way. The legislature has changed. And my role is not legislative, my role is to go into
the whole way. Notify the legislature that you have to give an unfair sentence because of their law.
I think I would probably discuss it with the Chief Justice and if there is an avenue to notify the legislature that it's unfair, then if it's a possibility, then yes.
We had a judge out in Pittsburgh who had a 10-year mandatory sentence on the person before. She said, I don't care. It's unfair to do this for the citizens. You know what they did to her after that? Yeah. You agree with me that not all laws are fair?
Yes.
Legislature is endowed with some sort of magic. Looking last, this idea was fair. I can make a lot of mistakes. What do you think of these courts, veterans courts, and the health courts?
the statistics that are coming out today, yes. Need more attorneys desperately. I think it definitely is a special person that walks into the field that wants to do this. They have to be passionate, compassionate, want to work with the families. These are heartbreaking scenarios that come before. And I've often seen in my 20 years, there's the men who are certified and they leave. Because they're burnt out, they don't want to do this.
Do you think people are wrongfully convicted?
Possibly, yes.
You say possibly.
Casey. We saved her for last because she goes the longest.
Just a couple of points. I know that I've been asked about the criminal bar experience, and I did have that as a note to delve into that. I will tell you that, I don't know if you've listened to particular tapes, but this council has voted for Superior Court nominees. These are folks who deal with murder trials and rape trials in the adult court. We've only had civil experience. So I'm pretty sure that would not be a disqualifier. It shouldn't be based on voting recommendations. Just on the criminal, though, because I will say that when nominees come in, normally if they don't have that background, they say, well, I've taken an MCLE, or I've sat in a trial session on this, this case or that case or this session. And I didn't hear that, but maybe because you weren't asked the question at that point. And what have you done since applying or getting your interview, or as you move through the process, when this started to become a possibility that you would be sitting here and bring yourself up to speed on the criminal? Because in Worcester County, I checked on the statistics, in Worcester County, where I'm from, 50% of the juvenile cases are plus or minus. So I would imagine that it's probably higher in Springfield, maybe lower in your area.
In my area, we've seen an incredible increase of violence in care and protection. And I would say it's 85% to 90% of the care and protection is already flooding the courts, so much so that the care and protection matters have to spill over onto the what have been assigned to delinquency days. And so, and that speaks up to the Juvenile Court Monday, Tuesday, Wednesdays are generally for care protections and Thursdays and Fridays for delinquencies, but the care protections overflow into Thursdays and Fridays in order to meet the needs of the influx and violence there. And I do believe that that is a statistic that is coming across the board. I believe most of there are not enough care protection attorneys to take cases. There are the certified counselors that are out there cannot take all the cases in the conflict.
That's fine about the CMP, but tell me what you've done since you became involved in this process to familiarize yourself with criminal law, because based on some of the comments, the judge is the most powerful position somebody can hold in the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. I'm fully convinced of that. You tell me, what other single person can take away your children, take away your wages, take away your freedom, take away your home, take away your parents? What other single individual in our entire government structure can do that? No one except the judge. So tell me what you've done on the criminal court. Tell me why you think that you'll be able to make the adjustment, because it is a very important part of juvenile court. I told you that.
So I attended a seminar, I believe it was the justice seminar of the juvenile court. It was held by, chaired by primarily was discussed the delinquency matters that are coming before the courts. And I attended that, I believe, this past winter. It was held at MCLE. I also have the juvenile delinquency source book that I've had from the beginning to the end, many of these matters turn into probationary matter, and then the CRA continues because the delinquent matter will wrap up with the probation finding, or not finding, but the child is going on to probation, and the CRA continues for at least 90 days. And so I participated in the delinquent cases in that.
Okay, and that's more of a comprehensive answer than I heard probably 25 minutes ago, so thank you for that. I'm glad I asked the question. With respect to the finding of delinquency, you said it was analogous to a guilty but not quite a guilty. Are you familiar with the Chardon case? Well, that's a case where a juvenile was adjudicated delinquent back, I'm going to say, when he was 12 years old. Yeah. 20 years later, he applies for an LTC, been a model citizen ever since. Works, taxpayer, has a home, beautiful family, you name it. Denied the local licensing authority, denied his application for an LTC, and our Supreme Court upheld that decision based on a delinquent delinquency adjudication that happened 20 plus years prior. What's your opinion on that case? Other than the fact that it's the law of Massachusetts, which I hope somebody would challenge that under the rationale that a juvenile brain is not developed for purposes of first-degree murder and parole. I don't know why it would be applicable to a case like that, but for some reason, our HGC has said it isn't. What's your opinion about that case?
My opinion would be that I think that developing a juvenile brain and a child committed this crime is very different from being successful in the community. They have a mortgage, they have a job, they have a successful family. It's not
did you follow the Justine Pelletier case? It was the case where it was in the news for, a couple of months, the family, a couple of years. It was really hot for a few months every day, but it went on for a long time. It was a case where a child was taken from her parents, they lived in Connecticut, I believe, and she was in Boston Children's or hospital in Boston. Her parents wanted to remove her, and the judge was saying, no, you can't. Yep, was involved in both states. Does that ring a bell?
It does ring a bell. I don't know the specific fact, but it definitely does ring a bell. It wasn't the first one.
Did you follow that case enough to give us an opinion about how you think it was handled?
I did not follow the case enough. It would be my understanding of the basic facts that you presented today is that DCF developed a child with an imminent risk in order to move the force to intervene. I'm not quite sure what the imminent risk was. I think that this withholding medical treatment could be wrong. But the child wanted medical treatment, the adults didn't want medical treatment. I'm trying to recall. And I think DCF stepped in because the child was at imminent risk.
What's your philosophy about that, understanding this case law and statutory law? As far as when a parent would like to perhaps use a certain or different type of treatment, a holistic treatment versus something that's more traditional or mainstream as far as treating a child.
I think as long as it doesn't put the child at imminent risk of abuse or neglect, the parent has the parental privileges to come to and raise the child. And I think that it would be balancing.
When you take into consideration, obviously, expert opinions and that analysis. I see that you've been in private practice for 21 years, so you must have started at age 11. Pretty amazing. You don't always see that, you know, that you've been out there for that long on your own. Learning the hard way and probably a lot of late nights getting up to speed on things that you could walk into, or if you were a big firm, walk into, an associate's office and dictate that some associate's going to do all kinds of legal research for you. Good for you. Do you think philosophically that the law should remain, that reunification should be the primary goal? recommendations or how they handle certain cases. I don't pretend to be a juvenile court. I have had probably a handful of cases, but I've been probate and family court a lot. And a lot of times you see these DCF caseworkers who are very, very young. They have limited educational, professional, limited life experiences coming into cases, and they want to rewrite people's lives and they are clueless to some extent about the ways of the world. So you have a degree of skepticism that you will or won't.
I do now, because I am an attorney that represents mothers and fathers as well as the children. And I do see many social workers coming through, and there's been no return. I often joke that my picture is on a dartboard because when I walk in, they're often not afraid, but they know that I will go in and call them on the carpet. But I'm
a lot of probate family attorneys would say that there should be a wall of fame, not shame, because we see a lot of problems in the cases that are in that court with DCF jumping the gun, or you know, they develop relationships with one side or the other, and there's bias and a lot of problems when you have people who aren't necessarily qualified, writing reports for the court that they can use for custody and parents. I just want to applaud you for holding your ground on the questions about whether you would just disregard the law and do what you felt was right. I think it's a good question. It's very insightful for us. But you know, can you imagine what type of society we would have if judges just did what they wanted every day of the week and every court in the Commonwealth? They just said, "Nah, I don't agree with that." I think it's an absolute trampling on our civil rights and our due process, and it would be very dangerous. That particular case at issue, I believe the Supreme Judicial Court just remanded that for sentencing. That was the Superior Court. She wasn't with the Superior Court. I think she was sitting in the district at the time. That case was sent back to her saying, take a look at this again. I don't think you got it right. And I agree with you that your role as a judge is to uphold the law, that you're not the legislature, you're not here running for office, you're here to be appointed for a lifetime tenure or age 70. I agree with you on that position, and I think it should be a universal position that nominees have. Right. I just want to touch on your education. You went to New England School of Law. Don't you prefer the name as New England School of Law versus New England Law?
I do. I often say New England School of Law, but I know now it's changed.
I still say Nestle. And most people respond to that. And you went to St. Michael's?
I did.
Did you play any sports up there?
I played tennis freshman year. And unfortunately, I got sick during the season. And I was unable to complete the season.
I went to a sumptuous place to play St. Mike's in basketball, and they would frequently do a number on us. We would make that long ride up from Worcester to Vermont. That was a pretty good athletic program. Governor's Council questionnaire, you were asked to please state any and all political contributions made by you, your spouse, or any of your children living at home, to any and all candidates for municipal, state, or national office, or to any political committees under Chapter 55 of the General Laws during the preceding 3 years. Your answer was none. My question is, why are you here? How are you here? You must be qualified. You don't always see that.
Good
for you. Mr. Chairman, I don't have anything else.
Thank you. I just have one question. second. You want the reputation of the Judge Phelan-Brown. You get arrested for a juvenile, you have no problem. Because you have an addiction problem. First time you fail the urine test, no problem. She make you break. She won't commit it. You even have a second break with Judge Phelan-Brown. Not going to commit it, so don't worry about it. Is that the right signal?
Just that pretty much completes the hearing. I received a number of